In the old days, commercial software was released on physical media, and distribution to customers was logistically significant. There wasn't any sort of internet, and in fact, most people didn't even have modems. And the idea of the web hadn't even been invented yet. You bought a box of floppies or a CD, went home and installed it. And if there was any sort of problem with the software, then you were just busted. There wasn't anything the company could do about it. The best they could do would be to produce either a patch or more likely a full new version of the software, put it out to the physical distribution channels, and hope that their customers pick it up. This is something that would take months or even years rather than the time that we have for updates right now. Even the internal process of developing and working on software was problematic. For example, in the Windows team, you had hundreds or thousands of developers who were working on the software, checking in fixes, and then waiting for a build to come out every day. If somebody made a mistake and that build broke the build and kept the updates from coming out, then you could actually wind up, depending on the time of the product cycle, sidelining anywhere from dozens to thousands of people for a full day. You can imagine how incredibly expensive this is and how eager companies were to avoid this sort of hiccup in their development cycle. One tool companies used to help mitigate this problem and to reduce the frequency of it occurring was process. Process that decided what sort of code could be checked in, what had to be done to verify the code before it got checked in, how builds would be checked before they got distributed to people's machines and possibly broke them, and so on. Process is a necessary evil for software development, but it also comes with a lot of baggage. So how do you get the right amount of process for your projects without paralyzing them? Hi, I'm John Miller, the Deliberate Engineer. I worked for 30 years as a software engineer in big tech at places like Microsoft, Amazon, and Google. I was a software engineering manager, principal engineer, and regular old software engineer. In addition to that, I also worked at research labs, academia, and in government. For today's video, I'm going to focus on talking about the process that Microsoft used in developing Windows NT, how that grew over time, and the good and bad things about it, what it provided, and what it cost, and the implications of it. And then we'll wrap up by talking a bit about what good process is to have in projects today. In the early days of development of Windows NT, there was a fair amount of process dictating how a given feature should be designed, how it should be implemented, coding standards that guided how it was produced, the amount of test coverage, and so on. The thing I remember about these guidelines and these processes was we were expected to follow them, but they weren't rigidly enforced. In other words, if you ignored some of the guidelines, if you ignored some of the process sometimes, you wouldn't necessarily be caught or stopped. My recollection of working on Windows NT in 1991 was that you did have to follow these coding guidelines and so on. I tried to be a good employee back then. So I actually followed the coding guidelines and the standards, made sure I had good test coverage and all that, only checked in when I was allowed to check in. And for that time period, most of the people were working hard to conscientiously follow the process, and so it worked out fairly well. As the project grew and mature, with more code and more developers working on it, build breaks began to happen a little more frequently. You would find that the build was getting broken several times a year, and this was either causing temporary hiccups or, in the worst cases, delaying releases by a day or more each time the code broke. Sometimes the code break was so basic that the code didn't even compile. A developer who had rigorously checked the code that they were planning to check in and then discovered a problem at the last minute, made a one-line fix to it and said, well, it's so obvious, I'm not going to bother checking it. Checked it in, and then you wouldn't find out until later that night or the next day that it had failed. Why did they do this? Because even running the basic build and checks could take you an hour or two, and that was time that people didn't necessarily want to invest for a relatively minor change. So the Windows NT team started building more gates and more protections against people checking in bad code, and these were actually formally enforced rather than being something that was voluntary and that wasn't being checked up on. The gates were at many different levels, and they varied a little bit depending on what you were doing. For example, for a bug fix, first you had to have an approval marking in the bug database that said, yes, this bug has been looked at, here's a priority, and it's approved for check-in under these circumstances. In addition to making the code, you had to have the code reviewed, had to run tests against it, and then you were allowed to check in, and then more tests would be run before it was integrated with the mainline and move forward. It was a fair amount of process. When you were talking about creating a change to a feature or adding a whole new component, then there was additional process in terms of the engineering and the creation of the design of that thing. So you might start with a vision document that would be reviewed by the upper managers and then put together a set of requirements that would talk about what the code should and perhaps shouldn't do, and prioritize those so that you would know how much you had to do before you had a shippable product, and what you should work on next if you had some extra time. Typically, you also had a test specification created either by the developer or by a dedicated test team if there was one, that was working based off the design or the implementation spec that the developer had put together, and talked about how they were going to test the code and how they're going to ensure that it was good. And just like the other development specifications, the test spec would be reviewed and modified based on feedback from both the developers and other testers. And again, all of these documents were well defined. The full constellation of documents that you should create for the biggest pieces of code had templates. They had an order they were supposed to be done. They had guidelines for who should be invited to reviews and what it took for it to be approved to move on to the next step. You didn't necessarily have to complete all of these different documents, but for the ones you had to do, there were templates and there was a process for creating them. And overall, that was a good thing because you could read a design document or you could read an architecture document from one person and know where to find things in it and know what to expect in it in terms of the type of content that they would provide. When it came time to code, you would develop your code in isolation on your local machine and get a good body of code up and running and working, including the tests, before you ever committed it to the mainline. Once you reached a sort of critical mass, then you would have not only peer code reviews of the code that you were writing, but a code review meeting that would talk about the overall design of the component as it was implemented and walk through the code. You would hand out printouts of thousands of pages of code. People would go over them offline, and then you'd get together in a meeting and walk through and figure out what needed to be changed for the code to be of acceptable quality and scope. So again, more process. With all of this process, you'd think that the code being checked in would be rigorously tested and it would be well documented, it would work correctly, and there wouldn't be any problems. But this just wasn't the case. People make mistakes. It's a natural thing to do. Things change simultaneously, so the two check-ins that get checked in together wind up breaking each other. And you also have people who are under tremendous pressure to deliver. They're in a hurry. They have to meet a deadline, what have you. In addition to that, you have people who will willfully break the rules because they don't think those rules apply to them, they don't need them, or because they really want to see some code get into the product and they've been told no and they want to sneak it in anyways. This absolutely happens. In short, the process that we had was adequate if everybody followed it, but there were still problems coming up, and so we needed more enforcement for the process. Parts of the process that hadn't been enforced before started becoming automatically enforced and enforced manually by managers. So if you checked in some code, a manager might go and look at the check-ins for a day and make sure that everything that was checked in was authorized. They might even spot check some of the check-ins to make sure that they weren't checking in some extra bonus code along with what they were supposed to be doing. There was also more automation and more gates to pass before you were allowed to check in. So for example, you had to run the tests locally and certify that you'd ran them. You wouldn't be allowed to check in unless you had the right bug with the right approval and automated checks that said, is this bug allowed to be checked in at this particular time, for example, as we go from the beta cycle and get ready to release the final product or not. So those would actually be enforced and keep you from checking in code without the right markings. No process is absolutely foolproof, so there were still breaks that happened. And whenever there was a break, there would be an investigation and follow-up, and they would say, well, how did this sneak through? How did this get past our enforcement gates? What are we missing? And they would add more enforcement gates, and they would add more process, and make sure that that particular type of failure never happened again in terms of enforcing who can check in when. So imagine this happening, you know, 5 times, 10 times, 100 times, each time adding another step to the process. There's two big problems with this growth of process. The first is that it just is more code. The process itself is automated. Suddenly it becomes a kind of product of its own with its own bugs and its own issues and its own mistakes. And that diverts resources and it takes time to fix. And in the meantime, when there's a problem with it, people aren't allowed to check in and you wind up causing the very problem you're trying to prevent. Secondly, because the code is always being added to and more steps are being added to the process, compute time and the time that it takes from the developer and the amount of elapsed time goes up dramatically. For example, the last time I was checking code into Windows was in the earlier mid-2000s. Even to check in a single line fix, I'd be looking at least 2 hours of my time to do all the steps that I had to do for the check-in. Get approval, attend a meeting to get approval, get the bug marked correctly, run all the tests locally for the different platforms that we compiled for, and then check it in. There would be another set of automated tests that would run against it in an environment that could take anywhere from half a day to 2 days to execute under normal circumstances. So to make my one line change in my source enlistment, I had to wait up to 2 days. It was extremely painful. Another problem is that old process never got retired. It was just this growing group of process, some of which didn't even apply anymore. There would be these esoteric checks that were being made. The person who'd created the check in the first place had vanished long ago. The people who understood how it worked were gone. Now it was just this piece that people were afraid to play with or to modify or to delete in case it led to some problem in the future. So you wind up with this larger, more crufty code base, which is, you know, not ideal for having a streamlined check-in process. To be clear, all of the Windows process was well-intentioned, but it's really a good example of process run amok, where the process becomes so unwieldy and so ungainly that it defeats the very things that it was trying to introduce. It's self-defeating. This isn't the right place for process today, and it wasn't the right place necessarily for process back then. But today we have a lot of extra technology and improvements to things that let us have a more appropriate, more streamlined process. First, you want to make sure that you've codified best practices for developing any software that's going to be shipped to customers. That means you have good coding guidelines, you have good testing guidelines, and so on, hopefully automatically enforced for any code that's going to be checked into a base that's going to result in a customer product. Without this, you really risk shipping broken, damaged, or just clunky code that doesn't work nearly as efficiently as it should. You don't want to do any of those things. Make sure you have process defined for design, coding, check-in, and testing and release. Like Windows, you should make sure that you have a list of the different design documents that may apply to creating a design, and you leave it up to the developer to figure out which of those documents they need to create. There should be a formal review process where it gets looked at and approved, a feedback process, and then a way to track the changes that are recommended and either accepted or rejected. You should have a good suite of development and test tools that people can use that's reliable, robust, and supports all the common operations, such as being able to go through code you're not that familiar with easily, enforcing coding guidelines, syntax, coloring, things like this. You should also have good processes for updating those tools, for doing a quality check before, for example, you change the IDE or you change the compiler that you're using. There should also be offline asynchronous processes that verify that no new bugs have been introduced in the system, at least for the set of tests that you have, and do things like code coverage analysis and static code analysis looking for bugs. You should have an automated process to help with check-in authorization and testing. In other words, it checks a bug or whatever the check-in message is to make sure that a check-in is authorized for the place that it's going to, and then it has a set of automated gates that run against that code and verify that it works correctly. If it's introduced a new problem that's blocking functionality, then that code change should be rejected and the developer should be notified to come and fix it. Otherwise, the code can be allowed to be checked in and integrated into the main line and move forward. These code compilation and testing processes should include both incremental builds and full clean builds periodically. You don't have to do a full clean build every time, but you don't want to wait too many days between full clean builds so that you can find out if there's some sort of a weird dependency problem that was introduced by a recent check-in. And then finally, you should have a certification process for builds before they're released either as betas or alphas or out to the public. The certification process should be well-defined. It should expect a certain pass rate for the code. It should be run on appropriate hardware and so on. And it should be as automated as possible. You shouldn't run it for the first time at certification, but you also shouldn't run it too frequently, as it can have its own problems that wind up misdirecting developers to look at things that aren't actually a problem. So you have to find a happy balance there. Summing things up, you have to have some sort of a process if you're working on a project where people need to collaborate. There needs to be something that decides that a design is good, it's been reviewed enough to be acceptable to be checked in, that code that's being checked in is appropriate for the time and the life cycle of the project to be checked in, that the code check-ins don't break any existing functionality, and ideally that they have sufficient code coverage and structure themselves to be correct, and that there's good release testing and automation to make sure that things are the way you want them to be for your customers. At the same time, the process needs to be as lightweight as possible with as little real-time delay as possible. So if you have to buy some extra machines that are going to be running these builds on their own, if you need to set up an asynchronous pipeline that has multiple things happening simultaneously to reduce that line, you should do both those things. You want to make sure the process is something that most of your developers will consider helpful rather than a blocker wasting their time. These days, especially in the services world, there's a lot less process than there used to be, in part because the cost of making a mistake is lower. You can ship out an update to a problem that you bump into in minutes or hours rather than in weeks or months or years. You can take a look and figure out which pieces of the process I'm describing here apply to the services world. My feeling is that most of it does, but also that if the process is broken a little bit, it's not nearly as bad as it is in a shrink-wrap software world like we had 20 or 30 years ago. So what do you think? Have you had to deal with ridiculously complex and convoluted processes as you're working in a production team? Are there things that you found especially useful or that you found especially useless, or things that broke more frequently than other stuff? I'd love to hear your war stories about this. So if you get a chance, leave a comment down below. Thank you for watching the whole video and listening to me rant, and keep on pushing forward. Hi, this is John. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please think about subscribing so you get notified of my future videos. Also, if you are interested, you might want to check out the video I have linked here. Thanks, and keep on pushing forward.